This podcast is brought to you by LMU Munich.
Thank you. So let me recall where we got to last time. So we have these D-brane categories. So it's a triangulated category, and our standard example for algebraic variety X, I could take, say, Calabi-Yau, I could take the banded derived category of coherent sheaves. So that's this category which has its objects, complexes, and morphisms, coming from morphisms of complexes, as well as putting in all these extra arrows for inverting quasi-isomorphisms. And then we had this definition of what's the stability condition. So it's a Bridgeland stability condition was a pair, sigma z, and then a collection of these p phi's. Find real numbers. So where the important point was, so z was homomorphism from, so remember k of b was our charge lattice, to the complex numbers. And then these p phi's were a collection of subcategories satisfying certain axioms. So p phi be certain subcategories with some axioms. I don't want to repeat the axioms because I discussed them and I haven't got that much to add. Let me just make a comment. So that was a question about it at dinner. So what are these p phi's? So I said that p phi should be thought of as the category of semi-stable objects, sigma semi-stable. So let me start using that notation. So so the point of a stability condition is that it tells us which objects are stable or which objects are semi-stable. So I'll comment on that in a minute. So sigma semi-stable objects of phase phi. So what does that mean? So an object of P phi is strictly semi-stable if it is composed of, so remember one of the axioms said that every object has a decomposition into objects of various phases, and so something is strictly semi-stable if it is composed of a number n which is larger than one of stable objects, I goes from 1 to n, so of p phi. Okay, so something is strictly semi-stable, and what does it mean to be composed of? So I haven't really done the axiomatics of triangles very much. If we were in somewhere like coherent sheaves, I would simply say that there is a kind of increasing filtration of E, so I could sort of find sub-objects of E, so composed of, so there is sort of filtration E equals, I should have done a better notation. So let me call these stable objects AI. So E is EN. Okay, so I'm going to use the notation which is not quite right, but let me do that anyway. E1, E0, such that these EI over EI minus 1 are isomorphic to AI, are stable of phase phi. OK, so this part of the definition should be in inverted commas. To write this out in the language of exact triangles would take me another few lines, and I haven't really done the axiomatics properly. The point is, here we're really working not in an abelian category, not in somewhere like sheaves, where one sheaf could be contained in another, but we're working in a triangulated category, so somewhere like complexes, where being contained doesn't really make sense. But the whole point of the axiomatics of triangles is I could sort of axiomatize this part of the statement and also that part of the statement, what it means to be a quotient in the language of triangles. Let me not do that, because that would really make the notation quite heavy. If you want to see what that means, just look in Bridgeland's papers. But I just wanted to give a sense of what's going on. So the what's going on here is that there's this category P phi, which has the stable objects, which you can't break any further into other stable objects. And then there are the semi-stable ones, which are composed of objects of the same phase. So they don't violate this this tachyon condition, but so they have some sub-objects which are stable of the same phase, and they're sort of composed. They're bound states of objects of the same phase. So they naturally live in this category of semi-stables. So something is strictly semi-stable if it's composed of more than one stable object.
Excuse me. What's the difference?
There's no difference. I'm just explaining. That was a word in there. It's exactly the same. There's a word in there, semi-stable, which wasn't explained in the axioms yesterday. So I'm just explaining. So this is all sort of hidden in this definition. I didn't define what is semi-stable. Yeah, right. This is exactly what I wrote yesterday. I just didn't explain the word semi-stable. There's no change. It's just I'm just commenting on the definition. Okay, so sort of once again, morally, what's happening here is every object of the category has this decomposition. It can be built up from objects, semi-stable objects of decreasing phases, and the semi-stable object itself has a decomposition into stable ones. So, for example, although that's not the only possibility. So, for example, if I have a stable object E in P phi, then direct sums E plus C, E plus C plus C, and so on, would be such semi-stables. So these are the kind of obvious ones. These are the ones where you can write them as a direct sum of copies of the same stable object. But if E has self-extensions, then there are other possibilities, and that's there are some very simple cases where one of these P phis is just generated by a single object. Maybe let's write down the easiest case, which does happen in examples such as the conifold, for example, is if P phi is generated by a single object. E in P phi, single stable object, which has no self-extensions. So in the language I introduced, I would want to say that H, so there's no maps from E to E. Always in trouble with these plus or minus ones. I think that's your x1. So I, this is when there are no self-extensions. There are no maps from E to E shifted by 1. I would write, again, in an abelian category, I would write x1 of E is 0. So then P phi really just has objects, some number of copies of E. So there's nothing else in there. And that's a particularly easy situation to analyze. in, for example, if you want to study wall crossing and so on. So that's a kind of very, very simple case, which does actually happen in simple enough examples. And so that's an easy case to analyze. If you have self-extensions, so the point about this condition is that this means that any time you have such a filtration, then it just splits into a direct sum. Whereas if you have self-extensions, then that's not the case. So let me now come to Bridgeland's theorem, about stability conditions. So this result was very much motivated, or perhaps implicit, in work of Douglas and partly Aspinwall. But as a mathematical result, it was quite unexpected, and certainly very beautiful. So denote, as we did before, by stab B, the set of all stability conditions and just to state the precise theorem I add here, which are locally finite, just because I'm writing it so formally, I want to have all the conditions. So that there is a technical condition which we can ignore. Set of all locally finite stability conditions on a triangulated category B, then there is a natural topology, even a metric, on step B. So you can say when stability conditions are far away or close enough, and the map. Okay, so that we have a map from step B to KB dual. I'll comment on this in a minute. So sending a stability condition Z P phi to Z. Okay, let me write down a formal theorem and then is a local homeomorphism onto a linear subspace of KB dual. Okay, so let me spell out. So this is quite a mouthful. So let me spell out what it says in human language. So first of all, what is this KB dual? So KB dual is just linear maps, homomorphisms from KB to C. So Z is just such an example. So the point is, part of our data is just a map from KB to C. So in the examples, KB is something like a finite rank lattice, or given that this is, I may as well complexify, is a finite dimensional C vector space. So this KB dual is also some finite dimensional C vector space. So just some number of copies of C. So that's where the central charge map takes its values. Now, what's a local homeomorphism? So this just says that for every point here, there is a neighborhood from which the map to the corresponding, it maps to the, some part of KB. And OK, so in general, it's not surjective, but there is going to be some linear subset here. So L in KB star, some slightly smaller, possibly slightly smaller vector space. And then this map, I should probably call it something psi. And then psi identifies a neighborhood of sigma with a small disk in L. So that's what it means to be a local homomorphism. Even even better said, what it means is sort of perturb Z, well, possibly in a linear subspace. But in fact, in the examples, this is not going to matter. And then sigma perturbs uniquely along. So although a stability condition is very much not determined by a central charge map, if I have a stability condition and I start sort of moving the central charge map a little bit, in other words, I change the phases of some of my objects, I just sort of move that a little bit, then I can actually lift it to this complicated structure of subcategories satisfying the axiomatics. So it's a very strong and very striking result. And as a corollary, step B is a complex manifold. Because basically what we are doing here, we are putting a complex topology on it. We are putting identifying bits of neighborhoods with disks in complex vector spaces. And you can just do that in a consistent way and get the structure of a complex manifold. So perhaps if you want to take away one message, then it's this one, that this construction of stability conditions defines a complex manifold for every triangulated category, in particular every D-brane category that you might be interested in. So as I said, this is a very striking result. In many ways, this is suggested by partial computations of Espinel-Moore and Douglas, but a full proof with all the detail and many of the essential ideas was written down by Tom Bridgeland in this Annals paper. So in the case, so in particular, in the case that we've studied most, so in the case when B is the bounded derived category of coherent sheaves on say a Calabi-Yau threefold X, we get what I'm going to call stab X, which is stab of DV coherent sheaves, which is it turns out to be the first approximation to mathematician's idea of what a Kähler structure moduli space really is. So let me just say briefly why this should have anything to do with Kähler structures. The point is that so in some limit, some examples of stability conditions. So I'm going to be very imprecise on this. I could spend a long time on that. I don't want to spend the rest of the lecture on this. But some examples of stability conditions are given, and really in some limit. By Giesecke stability on sheaves associated to a Kähler class omega on X. So you can use Kähler classes, you can use positive classes on X to give rise to stability. It turns out this works very beautifully on curves. In higher dimensions, it actually doesn't work quite so well. And maybe it's a good point to say that to write down explicit stability conditions satisfying the axiomatics has proved very difficult. I'll give you some examples some results in a minute. Not really examples, but some results in a minute. But it is very hard to write down a full package, so to speak, of all these subcategories together with the central charge. But you can use some better understood versions of stability, like Isaac's stability, at least to give limiting versions of some of this. So this is work of Tola and Bayer. And so in some limit, you can approximate, roughly speaking, parts of this stability space by understanding Kähler classes. And what you get here is some kind of extension. But there is a very important caveat, which is why I said that this is the first approximation to. So this is the caveat. So in examples, we really understand. And the examples are local Valpezzos. So where X is the total space of the canonical bundle of some Valpezzo surface. The dimension of this, so that there is no issue of taking a linear subspace. So this map psi from sub x to kb star is a local homomorphism, i.e. the dimension of stab is equal to the dimension of kb, say with complex coefficients. So we really get this result that I move around the central charges a little, I perturb my central charges a little bit, and I can lift that to the deformation of the whole package. But the point is that's too big. So recall what was our charge lattice. Recall that in this example, kb is something like, well, it's not something like, it's equal to the even cohomology of x, say, with complex coefficients. And that's too big. So the dimension of kb, therefore, is the full even cohomology. So it's, let's put it this way, 2 plus 2 h11 of x. And that's too much. So therefore, this is the dimension of stab. So you can, there is an issue of normalizing a stability condition where you want to make the central charge of the point object 1, maybe, then that's a reasonable thing. And you can achieve that. So everything here is invariant under rotations acting on C. So you can sort of cut one dimension from this in some kind of easy way. But this is sort of twice as big as you would expect it. If we got half this number and then cut one dimension, we'd roughly be where we want to be, which is a complexified Kähler cone has dimension, complex dimension h11, the second better number. But we got twice as much. And this is a fundamental problem. So in physics, this is called the extended Kähler moduli space. Which has dimension the full even cohomology. So Witten in physics and Zivran in mathematics has speculated on the role of this in these sort of type 2 string theories. But most work, of course, is done on the extended Kähler cone, which is what you would have hoped to get.
Concretely for O minus 3?
Right, so concretely O minus 3, Tom has a very long paper where he identifies, where he tries to find the right structure, tries to identify, that was going to be my next point. So in concrete examples, you can sort of use what you know about various structures to put the actual sort of complexified Kähler cone into stab. And what seems to happen is that it is actually quite a transcendental embedding. So in some sense, what seems to be happening is stab of B is too much of a linear object. What you expect is some kind of curved or perhaps transcendental object sitting in there. And Tom and other people have spent a lot of time trying to guess what extra structure you need to put on stab to be able to say what perhaps some sort of foliation where some part of some leaves would be the space you're looking for. It's not clear. So this is not that.
From the quiver, you'd expect one complex dimensional, two real dimensional space.
No, I mean this will give you a two complex dimensional space. I mean. Yes, right, because you have so in the quiver language, back to this picture. So, okay, so local P2, and this is really, I won't be able to define everything there. So we just, but because we just had this. So we have this quiver, which is the quiver description of local P2. You have your three simple objects, S1, S2, and S0, S1, and S2. And you want to give the phase, you want to give the images. So a stability condition will be, at least on some open set, will be defined by giving the central charges of these three, all in the upper half plane. That's three complex dimensions. Now, you might want to normalize it so that the point object, which is, I think, the sum of these three, would go to one, but that still leaves you with two complex dimensions. So very naturally, mathematically, you get a two complex dimensional space.
But these are related by electromagnetic
duality, essentially. Yeah, but that's a discrete symmetry. That's not a continuous symmetry.
No, but OK.
Right, right. I mean, you should really explain. I mean, if you have ideas, I mean, Tom is really the right person to address this to. So if Tom, you're watching. I think, yeah, I mean, there's a question. So in this example, there's a one-dimensional space, which we understand. There's the Picard-Fuchs description. There's all kinds of descriptions of it sitting in a two-dimensional space. In this particular case, it is possible to write down embedding of one into the other. So this particular case is sort of understood. What's not understood is how to resurrect that one-dimensional space just from stab, which is what you would really like to do. Here is your category. Here is your space of stability conditions. It's got dimension too much. But on it, there is some intrinsic structure, which gives you what you would call the normal full Kähler moduli space. We can do it in the example because of extra information we have. Well, Tom can do it in this example. But it's... Well, it's not. Yeah. Okay. Right. So this example is very analyzed in a paper of Bridgeland in much detail. Local, T structures. On some. So this is a paper from Bridgeland on some local C by threes or something like that. That he analyzes this example in great detail. But the fundamental subtlety in general certainly remains. So here we really know enough that you can give many, perhaps, different descriptions. But in general, this is an outstanding question, how to find the right thing in there. So let me just mention a couple of other results on this stability manifold and then move on. So one example that's kind of very pretty is when x is the elliptic curve. So just one final time. So in that case, let me not give the details, but it's very easy then to find out what is the stability manifold. It is just a copy of the complex numbers times the copy of the upper half plane. And now the stability manifold always has an action of automorphisms of the category. So this in particular will be acted on by automorphisms of DB of E, or we might these Fourier Mercator transforms, auto equivalences. And that's always true. And this is some discrete group acting there. So perhaps you might want to consider the quotient. And if you do that, then this is, of course, this extended SL2 that we discussed yesterday. And so if you take the quotient, then so here you have, if you quotient on this side, it turns out that you end up with this guy. Sorry, if you look at the projection to H and then quotient, then on the H part, you just get an action of the standard PSL to Z. And this is a C star bundle, because the C, turns out, gets quotiented by a translation. And so the point is, what is this? So this is your this is what you might want to call your sort of Kähler moduli in this case. There is no issue of extra dimensions here because we are too small. And then you remember the elliptic curve is self-mirror, and then we recognize this as so what is this space on the complex side? So on the complex side, this is what's sometimes called a gauge moduli space, where, so here you have just the moduli space of complex structures, and the C star bundle just corresponds to a choice of generator. So i.e., choice of generator of the sections of the canonical. So it's, of course, a one-dimensional space is a unique Nova vanishing form up to scalar, and the C star bundle corresponds to choosing that scalar. So here, at least, you have a kind of very, very pretty correspondence between the Kähler moduli space, which is the C star bundle over one copy of the upper half plane quotiented, and it is the gauged complex moduli space. And that C star here is, in terms of stability, is just the rotations of your central charge map. So at least in simple examples, it really fits in very, very nicely with what you expect. And then let me just say that one other case where stability is now computed, some other cases, shall we say, where step x is known. So it's known for curves. That's not very hard, although P1 does present some surprises. So some fun for x equals P1, where something unexpected happens. I'll leave you to figure out what it is. So the next example is x is a minimal resolution of C2 mod gamma. So this example has now featured extensively, gamma, a finite subgroup of SU2. So in this example, so this is work of again, Bridgeland himself, and then for the A case, and then, this is his work. So in that case, stab of x, turns out to be very close related, or possibly exactly, as I haven't looked it up, is what you get by looking at, this notation, what was it called? I mean, it is the Cartan. So this is isomorphic to some C to the R minus the root hyperplanes divided by the Y group. So this is a non-singular. So if you take away the root hyperplanes, then maybe you don't actually. Sorry. You don't divide by them. Sorry. Just take away the root hyperplanes, and then this is something like the universal cover. So this is closely related to the universal cover. And this is of course again close related to the autoequivalence group of the corresponding D of X having this subgroup, which was the extended which was the braid group, which featured yesterday. So I told you yesterday that the braid group of the relevant type is shows up in as Fourier Mukai transforms, and that's close related to the fact that the stability manifold is roughly speaking the universal cover of the complement of the root hyperplanes. I'm sorry, I haven't looked up the precise theorem here, so I'm doing this from memory. But these all fit together in a kind of very nice and satisfactory fashion. And then one other example, which has recently been computed fully, is x equals p2. So not the Calabi-Yau, but actually the projective plane. And there really a lot of fun happens. So there's some fun for P1, and for P2, it's a very intricate structure. So this is a very beautiful paper of Bayer and Makri from last year. So this was, again, Tom. And so x equals P2, there is fractal structures cropping up and all kinds of funky stuff there. So that's a really interesting story. So you have a quiver description for part of it, and then you also have a kind of geometric description. And it turns out that the geometric and the algebraic descriptions fit together, but in really quite intricate ways. And they do, and local P2. So there are results. And let me now say admit to a sort of big failure on part of this theory, which is that so far, no example currently known of a stability condition, Bridgman stability condition on a compact Calabria 3-4. So that's kind of disappointing, you could say. Maybe I should have listed one more. I'm not going to write this down. For K3 surfaces, there is a lot of information available. Not a full description, but there is a lot of information available. But there is no example known of a stability condition for compact Calabria 3-folds. There is some recent progress. People haven't given up. But it really seems to be a rather intricate problem. So, of course, that's where we started from, say something like the quintic. Construct a stability condition on the quintic. And there's a lot of partial information available. And now there is a scheme for construction, but it hasn't been completed because it relies on some difficult results on sheaves on compact Calabrials like the quintic. Okay, so any more questions? That's pretty much all I was going to say about stability per se. It's a developing subject. There are new results. But the theory isn't in any way complete yet. Okay, so I want to spend the last hour or so talking about counting D-branes. So, Giesecke stability wouldn't do the job. Giesecke stability, as it stands, doesn't give you a full. It tells you when some sheaves are stable or unstable, but it doesn't really extend to this full package of stability on the Dirac category. It does versions of whichever stability you take for curves; they're all equivalent, and they do the job for curves. On surfaces, you start from Giesecke stability, and you have to, in the technical term, is tilt it a little bit. You have to poke around with the points a little bit to get a stability condition. That's done in a paper of Tom's. But for three-folds, it's harder. You have to poke around with curves first and then points, and it's not known how to consistently poke around. I mean, you start from something like Giesecke, but Giesecke itself will not give you the full package. Mm-hmm. That's right. Okay. So that's a very good question. Yes, in theory, yes. I don't know if it has been extensively done. It really relies on a very, very thorough knowledge of and control over the category, which we have for the Dirac category of coherent sheaves, and possibly not for Fukaya. To be honest, I don't know any. I mean, in theory, it applies to any triangulated category. Sorry? That's right. I mean, you have to certainly. That's right. So you certainly have to complete. Have to put in the. Have to soup it up to a triangulated category or a full A infinity category, which you then truncate back to a triangulated category. I don't know any non-trivial results, but it certainly should apply. It does apply somehow, and that's a very interesting. And that's yet again the power of mirror symmetry. The initial ideas, as I sort of hinted yesterday, the initial ideas on stability came from Lagrangian geometry. It was there where people first started to understand what is this issue of bounding brains to each other and wall crossing and so on. So this is work of Joyce and Koncevich and Aspinwall and various other people. It was then realized that actually the tools are much better on the other side. The axiomatics was formulated by first Douglas's pi stability and then more precisely by Tom. And then now there's this extensive theory for the Dirac category of coherent sheaves. It hasn't really. Trying to think, I've not seen any. I mean, there are explicit descriptions of the Fukaya category in terms of its infinity structure, but I'm not sure if anyone's really studied Bridgman stability per se on them because it sort of assumes a lot of control over your Homs and X and so on, which you wouldn't necessarily have on the Fukaya side. I may be missing some papers here. I haven't really followed that side of the development, but in theory it should apply. In theory it applies to any triangulated category. What? Okay, so D-brane counting. So I'm going to give a kind of again a kind of general introduction to what one might mean by D-brane counting. So perhaps before I do that, let me just an aside. So reminder about sad duality, because in a minute that's kind of going to be important. So there are various ways you could write sad duality. So sad duality, of course, is a very important feature of one of our basic computational tools about sheaves. One version that you might find in books is, say, if X is a smooth projective variety, then xi of, for, say, ENF coherent sheaves, xi of ENF is isomorphic to x dmax minus I f e tensor omega x joule. So these are both finite dimensional vector spaces, both finite dimensional C vector spaces. So this is one version of stating sad duality, and it becomes a statement about cohomology if they're both locally free, say. So if X is a smooth projective Calabi-Yau variety, so here, oh my god, oh, maybe I wrote this kx before. So kx, this is a line bundle of top differentials. So if x is smooth projective Calabi-Yau variety, so kx is trivial, then this, of course, doesn't do anything. So then we simply get xi ef is isomorphic to x dimension of x minus I Fe joule. And so now I can sort of think about this. So I mentioned a little bit that this is these shifts have to do with, so this I could write as H, E, and F, I in my notation. So now you get a general expression of sad duality in our brain category for a Calabi-Yau 3, for say a Calabi-Yau, okay, let's specify a Calabi-Yau 3 threefold, would say that H of ENF I is isomorphic to H F E 3 minus I joule for ENF to brains. So that's a very useful way of writing things, but of course it's also a kind of very pretty way of writing things, which says that at least in these Calabi-Yau situations, the sad duality can be expressed very briefly just using the basic structures of our triangulated category, namely the Hom spaces and the shifts. Okay, so let me now talk about D-brane counting, and you'll see in a minute why I put in this little aside. So so let B be some category of D-branes on a C by 3. So in particular, have sad duality as in plus. Okay, so I want to fix some stability condition, sigma sum stability condition. on B. So that sort of tells us what are the physical branes. And so here is a very simple observation, which I think is due to Turin. He wouldn't have written it in this form, but the basic observation is due to him. Well, he would have written it in essentially this form. So let me take some sigma stable object. In fact, that won't be relevant for a minute. Let me just take an object in B. So then E sits in a moduli space. Of objects of B. So after all, B is not just some kind of discrete category. We know what it means to deform a sheaf. We know what it means to deform a Lagrangian. So each of these categories comes with extra structure. Each of these categories comes with this extra structure of knowing what deformations are. And we have, so this is some moduli space M of objects. And then the standard yoga of deformation theory tells us the following. So deformation theory tells us two things. It tells us what's the tangent space at E of M. And in the language I've been using, I would write this as H of E, E1. So normally I would write this as X1 of EE. And that's a sort of standard fact about if you ever seen deformation theory. This is part of this. So what's the tangent space? The tangent space in algebraic geometry is obtained by looking at the ring of dual numbers, or it would just say first order Taylor series. And if you just think about that a little bit, giving a deformation over this ring is equivalent to giving an extension of E by itself. So this doesn't take very long to write out. It's part of standard deformation theory. But you can just take this for granted, that we know what should the tangent space be. But in these interesting cases, actually, there are obstructions. And the obstructions to deforming, and I'll say in a minute what that means. So the obstruction space is isomorphic to the next cohomology group, which in this language I would write like this. And so how to think about that? So this is roughly saying that the number of deformation directions, which is this dimension of the tangent space, is constrained by the dimension of the obstruction space number of equations. So this is my one-line summary of Kuranishi theory. So Kuranishi theory says that you have your deformation parameters, which are basically local coordinates on the tangent space. But these deformation parameters are subject, in general, to equations. And the equations take values in the obstruction space. So a sort of Reader's Digest way of saying it is that there is a number of deformation directions, which is that much, and is constrained by that many equations. So the observation was the following. So suppose that we are in some kind of ideal situation. Suppose that the equations are, in some sense, are what's called transversal, i.e. they all matter. They all cut the dimension down. Then we would expect the dimension of this moduli space to be the number of variables minus the number of equations. And I told you what's the number of variables and what's the number of equations. So this is the dimension of the tangent space, which is H E E1, minus the dimension of H E E2. And in general, this is what's called the expected dimension of M. So if this doesn't happen, then maybe the dimension is larger, but it still makes sense to talk about the expected dimension. And you have seen one computation like this before yesterday in Albrecht's talk, where he computed the expected dimension of the moduli space of curves to Calabi-Yau threefolds. It was kind of hidden in the bottom of one of the boards. I'm not sure if everybody got that. But you can write down a similar computation for the dimension of MgN bar of x. So that's the moduli space of marked, or let's forget about marked, so Mg bar of x, the moduli space of genus G curves mapping to Calabi-Yau threefold. There's a very similar expected dimension computation. And the answer is also the same. So what's the answer, of course? We are in this Calabi-Yau situation. We have, in particular, equation plus, which I hope I haven't deleted. I may have deleted. That was a mistake. Equation plus told us that these spaces are dual. So the dimension here is identically zero. So this is a point where C/3, so from now on, I haven't got very much more to go. From now on, everything is going to be C/3. So this is an essential point. So a lot of this stability stuff worked for Calabi-Yaus of any dimension, and in fact, non-Calabi-Yaus as well. We are now very much back to Calabi-Yau threefold. So this point essentially relies on Calabi-Yau 3. On the other hand, in the C/3 case, you get a very strong result. Normally, you would expect such a computation to end up with some Godin mass of, at very best, churn classes of your sheaf or something. But here, there is just no information you need. The power of sagittality gives you that this number is identically zero. OK, so what does that tell us? Well, it tells us that we, at least somehow in this ideal situation, we're talking about a zero-dimensional problem. What sigma, what stability should give us, in general, it's some kind of boundedness. So the moduli space is not going to be too big. So we have a M, the sort of finite zero-dimensional moduli space. And if you see that, then, of course, what you should do is you should associate an invariant to this. So get an invariant, which is the number of points somehow appropriately counted in that moduli space. And this is our D-brane count. So let me just go through this part of the argument one more time. So let's assume that we're in Calabi-Yau threefolds. We have a stability condition, which somehow bounds the size of our moduli spaces. Then you look at the local theory, and the local theory will tell you that there are as many obstructions to deforming as deformations. So if all these obstructions are effective, so if they all cut down the dimension, then you expect a zero-dimensional moduli space, and then you expect to be able to count the number of points in there. And that should give you, that has all the ingredients you wanted. So it's got Calabi-Yau 3 in there. It's got the brane category in there. It's got stability in there. So this should be a count of physical brains. So this kind of idea has sparked a lot of activity, both in maths and physics. And I'm really now going to give you, in the little time I have, some of the account of the mathematical work that goes on in here. So a lot of you sort of have seen various versions of D-brane count. So first of all, I want to point out the problems that as a mathematician one faces in sort of making this precise. But actually, if you sort of meditate on these problems, then they actually give you something new. So first of all, let me say that. So in this generality that I was talking, what I'd like to call M sigma of B, so this is the moduli space of objects in B of stability condition sigma, is difficult to construct. And it's not even clear what kind of space you get. Clear. What space you get. So we are in a fair amount of generality here in terms of mathematics. We're having these, we have this infinity structure or this derived structure. Moduli spaces of objects there is some sort of uncertainty about what that should precisely mean. So there's some work in progress due to various people to make this precise. That's sort of highly mathematical, and I don't think people here will be interested. I mean, one solution is just to concentrate on special sigma, special or limiting sigmas, in the sense I talked about before. So for example, we of course know that if we just look at moduli spaces of Giesecke stable sheaves, then we have GIT, which will tell us that that's a quasi projective or projective variety in favorable circumstances. So that's certainly possible. And Richard Thomas' his thesis was introduced what are now called DT invariants, which certainly do a great deal of. He's certainly done a great deal of work to make this precise in some special cases. Again, some of the one of the main issues was, has already been mentioned at this school. You want to put what's called the virtual fundamental cycle on this moduli space, and in favorable situations that has been constructed by Richard Thomas. So in some situations we know what we mean, and I hope to get to some examples at least before time runs out. Now, the second problem, which is sort of related, is that even if we can construct this M sigma B, it's almost never actually zero dimensional. It's it's of high dimension and very singular. So I think I'll have time just to discuss one example, which will be an example both for all these features. And then the third point is that if we can construct it, so need a construction of the obstruction theory. Let me not spend time on this. So you need to construct. Make it precise, what do you mean by the obstruction theory? And it has to have a special form. It needs to be what's called a perfect obstruction theory. And that leads to some mathematical constructions. I don't want to spend time on that. Let me go on. So in some sense, OK, so what do you do with these higher dimensional moduli spaces? So in some sense, again, Witten told us the answer. So if this M sigma B is of too large dimension, then we know by Witten that we should take some kind of Euler number. So this has, of course, been the standard feature of the theory, that you say if your dimensions are too large, then let's take the topological Euler number. And there are various reasons why that might work, in favorable cases. What in general you want to do, take what's called a virtual Euler number of this moduli space. I really should now write E. So the part of the moduli space that contains a particular object. So in general, this is still very big. It still has many components. Or maybe I'll just put a zero there. So look at a particular component. So I haven't been very precise here. So certainly the Chern classes will give you components. So if let me just put a zero there to indicate that I've chosen a particular component. And so that's an integer. So you have to define what you mean by the virtual Euler number, but there are now very good definitions. So this is called a virtual Euler number. There's work of Behrend, which gives a very precise meaning to what we might mean by that. So that's very good. So in favorable situations, we can construct this space, and we have the technology to look at this virtual, to construct something which we call the virtual Euler number. But of course, if a mathematician sees that, then one immediately says, well, that's a little bit dishonest. What you're really doing here is what you should be, what the Euler number does. If there wasn't any ver here, and for example, this would be nice and non-singular, then the Euler number is just an alternating sum of Betti numbers. So why forget about these individual Betti numbers? Try and sort of concentrate on the geometry and not just sort of take out this crude numerical measure, but actually think about the what's called, for example, the Poincaré polynomial. So think about the whole Poincaré polynomial, which is the sum of the Betti numbers t to the I, and then if I sum minus 1 to the I times the Betti numbers, I of course get the Euler number. So because our moduli spaces are higher dimensional and they are not just isolated points, we are very naturally led to this idea that instead of looking at numerical numbers, we should perhaps be looking at the whole Poincaré polynomial. And okay, so there's a very important technical difficulty here that we're not really looking at the Euler number, and we haven't really got something non-singular, but we're looking at this strange virtual Euler number coming from some kind of crazy obstruction theory of some very singular variety. So there is then the technical question of how do you refine that to a polynomial. So the question here is refine the virtual Euler number to a Poincaré type polynomial. And then if you want the final question, which will of course be very natural for all of you guys, is that we're perhaps not really interested in individual invariants, but we are interested in the partition function. So I could write down some sort of z sigma in some multivariable. So this is point number 5. So here I'm taking classes in the K theory or in this charge lattice of my category, and I'm looking at the virtual Euler numbers of the moduli space of sigma stable objects in B of class alpha. So here these are E sigma stable, and the charge or the charge of E is alpha. That's an element of the charge lattice. And then I put in sort of Q to the alpha here. What I mean by this in general, if this charge lattice is of higher rank, is I could just take some basis and I just take some multi-index. So this is sort of written in multi-index notation with respect to some basis. Or in general, you might want to, or alpha in some sublattice of the charge lattice. So there are various versions of this, and I might want to put a lambda here. So you can decorate this a little further. But the whole point is that it turns out that in this story, individual DT invariants are perhaps not so interesting and often hard to compute. But the whole partition function is sometimes a lot more interesting, and there are ways to compute the partition function which are very powerful and sometimes give very, very striking results. And then you can deduce individual invariants from them. Right, so I've got 25 minutes. This is where our talk could start. So let me see how I'm going to cram that into 25 minutes. So I really want to give, so this has been all very, very general. I really want to give an example where these features 1 to 5 become sort of more apparent. So let me give you an example. So this is going to be, it's going to last as long as we have. So x c by 3 So I said that our first problem is to this is too general. So let's try find parts of the world where we can work in. So this would in physics you would call this the D0 D6 brane story. And in mathematics you would call it the Hilbert scheme of points. So let me briefly say what do I mean by this. So in mathematics, I would like to say, so which object? So here I have this category of brains, which is the derived category of X. So this has all these sheaves in it and so on. But I want to concentrate on the part of the category formed by objects which look as follows. So you might remember I talked about sort of the standard exact sequence where I take the functions in a particular subvariety. But one thing I could do is I could just take n points. So these are n distinct points. So sheaves on a point are just complex numbers. Sheaves on a point is the same as functions on a point. It's the same as values. So what this really is, this is just a direct sum of n copies of. I mean, it's again the same sort of thing as we had for Lagrangians, but just now thought of as a coherent object. So there's not much going on there. I can look at functions and restrict them to these points. What I get here is the ideal sheaf of these m points. So I want to concentrate on the part of the category that contains objects like this. And why is it called a D0, D6? So what I'm doing here, I think, in physics, is I'm going to bound n points onto the rank 1 full D6 brane, which is just a trivial line bundle. So this you should think of as a full D6 brane, just a trivial D6 brane. Just take one copy of X and then bound to it a bunch of points. And if you look at that bound state, then mathematically the object you're looking at is this this ideal sheaf. Now the reason why that's very nice is I don't really have to specify. So somehow implicitly this means I've chosen a stability condition. So sigma is kind of implicit here. And so I can forget about that. Let's think about what happens. So let me call Mn of X the moduli space of such brains. So like IPn for n distinct points. So it turns out that this is a very, very good, well, in some sense, a very well-defined mathematical object. And in mathematics, this is called the Hilbert scheme of n points on X. What's the issue here? The issue here is the following. So if I take n distinct points, there is no argument about how I arrange them on the space. They're going to just lie at n distinct points. Now, if I start sort of deforming this configuration, what happens initially is that these endpoints are just going to start wiggling in some open set. But at some point, something more dramatic happens. And at some point, two points might decide to walk to the same place and form some kind of configuration, which is two points on one top of each other. So you guys would have no problem. You just say that two D0s here sitting on top of one another. But mathematically, I really want to understand what happens to these sheaves as these points collide. And it turns out that mathematically, I really want to treat that as a problem of ideal sheaves of the structure sheaf. That's part of being in the stability condition. And every sheaf that arises is going to be a subsheaf of the structure sheaf. And then I really have to sort of specify, need to specify structure on sort of 2 times p as a subvariety or subscheme of C3. So I have to give an algebraic structure to that stack of 2 points which collided. And the mathematical way to do that is to treat this all in the language of commutative algebra and the language of ideals. And there's actually extra data that goes into specifying that. So just saying 2 points is not enough. There is extra data. And mathematical way to express that need for extra data is to say that there is a map. There exists a map from this space Mn of x, the Hilbert scheme, to the nth symmetric product of x. So the nth symmetric product is just your naive understanding of points with multiplicities. So I take, so here we're just parametrizing unordered n tuples of points of x, possibly with multiplicities, possibly with repetition. So this would be your naive space of points stacked on one another. So that really would just have 1 point for the configuration where I have one here, and 2 there. But it turns out that if I really want to treat this as an object, as a part of this D-brane category, I have to work with this much more complicated space. And this is a highly non-trivial map.
Yeah, of course.
And in fact, yeah, I mean, that's somehow the moral of the story I'm going to tell you is that it seems to know a hell of a lot. Sorry for the caricature. Yes, of course. That's right. So if n is equal to 1, then isomorphism. So n, which is the dimension of x, equal to 1. Then this is an isomorphism. If n is equal to 2, then it's a resolution. It's a nice, a crepant. So Calabi-Yau, it's a Calabi-Yau resolution of singularities. But life is not so easy. We've not been given any of these dimensions. We're given a nasty dimension. So any, and so especially if n is at least. OK, so I've kind of covered point one. So we have a nice space. Let me get to point two. So I sort of said, started saying that this is a non-trivial space. But let me just say quite how non-trivial it is. So as in my starting point, which was n distinct points, of course, the configuration space of n points in x is a subset. So this is n distinct points, n distinct unordered points on x. And that's a nice moduli space, that as long as the points don't hit each other, nothing much happens. That's kind of the boring, in some sense, the boring part. And of course, the dimension of this configuration space is 3n. Because what freedom do I have? Well, I have to put endpoints on a three-dimensional space, not being equal is an open condition, and I just divide by discrete group. So the dimension is 3n. On the other hand, the dimension of this mnx is absolutely vast, is much, much bigger. It's of order n to the 4/3. This is a mathematical result. It's in the language of algebra, it's not very hard to prove. But it's a striking result from our point of view. It says that, in some sense, points which kind of come together and form these stacks of branes is really a very, very small part of the space. Somehow, what's happening there is that a lot of the stuff in this moduli space is actually formed of bound states of these zero branes sitting on each other, which doesn't deform out. And that's sort of very much there. And in fact, part of the story I'm going to tell says that it really these configurations really are there. and you have to sort of treat them with respect. One thing that's been done in mathematics is to say, okay, let's just look at, so this will have a component which is just really those configurations which sort of hit together, which is called a principal component. So I'm just going to take a mathematical language. I would take the closure of this in here. That's a respectable thing to do. It's got dimension 3n. One doesn't understand that much about its structure, but it doesn't seem to play any role in the story related to physics. I don't know any theorem which would connect that part of the space to any of the physical ideas, whereas this one has very strong connections to the physics. It was pointed out by Jefferies some time ago, possibly only privately, that this 4/3 might not be a random number, but it might have to do with some scaling dimension in something or something other. I don't really know what he meant or how to make sense of this. But this number doesn't seem to be completely random. Okay, so it's a tough singular space, and also so for in n equals a dimension of x, n is, oh, I'm sorry, n is kind of bad. Whoa. I really delete the n's from here. I meant the dimension of x. Maybe I answered a different question from the one you asked. So there are two parameters here, the dimension and the, so all those statements are true. Perhaps that's not what you asked. Okay, sorry, so I answered the wrong question before. So all those statements stand. If the dimension of that, if you are talking about a curve, this is an isomorphism. If you're talking about a surface, it's a Calabi-Yau resolution. Okay, so to answer your question, yeah, so n equals 1, that's right, m1 of x is just x. N equals 2, m2 of x is just the blow up along the diagonal of sim2 of x. So non-singular. So if n equals 3, then there's still some relatively nice construction. M3 of x is isomorphic to some iterated blow up of sim3 of x. So you have to first blow up what's called a small diagonal where all points coincide, and then you blow up the large diagonal where two points coincide, and this is still non-singular. And for n equals 4, it's an irreducible variety, which is singular with a very nice singularity. So it's possibly Sheldon Katz who wrote this down first back when he was young, but it seems to have been a colloquial result already in his time. So people understood what, maybe it goes back to Yarubino. I don't know the history. Certainly Sheldon has a nice paper on the four-point Hilbert scheme on threefolds back in the early 80s. And at some point, of course, for very large n, it can't possibly be irreducible because it has this irreducible component of dimension 3n, but its dimension is much bigger. So at some point, it becomes really nasty. No one quite knows when it happens. I think it's an unsolved problem at which n it becomes reducible. So what's interesting is that a lot of people make a living out of studying the Hilbert scheme, and all their combined efforts haven't been enough to answer even some of the simple questions that one would like to understand about this space. So it really commands some respect. So now to its DT invariant. So we have a space, and Richard Thomas has also constructed the right sort of obstruction theory on this. So if X is a Calabi-Yau threefold, then MnX carries an obstruction theory of the kind we need, and this is a result of Richard Thomas. So we can indeed form what we could just simply call the nth d0, d6, dt invariant of X, which is this virtual number of points in the Hilbert scheme. And so of course you see from this list that just one final reminder that this n to the 4/3 is a virtual dimension zero space. So that this is very much not actually zero dimensional. But nevertheless, we have the technology and we can compute this thing. And then there is a theorem which in the form I'm stating it was proved by various groups of people at the same time. So Behrend and Fontecchi, Jun Li, Levin and Pandori Pandey. And then it's a conjecture earlier by this famous paper comparing Donaldson-Thomas theory to Gromov-Witten theory by Malik Nekrasov, Okonkov and Pandori Pandey. So what's the theorem? So if you form the generating series t to the n, say 1 plus n greater or equal to 1, then this is equal to some universal power series m of t to the topological Euler number of x, where m of t is a sine version of the MacMahon function, minus t to the n minus n. And product. So this is the first appearance in the subject of the MacMahon function. Ultimately, it was Digraph who somehow noticed that the MacMahon function should play some interesting role in this theory. So there's a long history here. So that's really one of the sort of basic statements in the subject, and there's some other names that I've, I'm sure, skipped. But this is the sort of what I said about computing the partition function. So the proof of this depends on two or three ingredients. One would be localization computation for toric Calabi-Yau's, where you can do that kind of thing. Then the next would be extending that localization computation to arbitrary Calabi-Yau, and there are various methods to do that. But the fundamental fact remains that it's somehow much easier to treat the whole partition function, and the whole partition function has a much nicer answer if I want to write down an explicit DT invariant out of this, then it wouldn't be a particularly illuminating expression. But if the whole partition function has this very nice form. So that, in some sense, sort of concludes part of that program, because what it says is that we can define these invariants, they make sense, and the answer also sort of hopefully makes sense from a physics perspective. So it really is a kind of satisfying conclusion. And just to amplify on the point I made earlier, part of this computation is a localization computation. If you just say take the simplest toric variety, which is C3, and the same question there makes sense, and the localization makes sense, and the things that contribute to the MacMahon function from localization are only clusters of points which are all concentrated at the origin in a particular torus invariant fashion. Some of those will not deform out. If you somehow insisted on treating just the large component, then you may not be able to see all of them, or at least you wouldn't be seeing all the deformations in the right way, and so you would perhaps get a different answer. I don't really know what answer you would get, but to get to this answer, you very much have to treat on equal footing all these clusters, all these collided stacks of these D-branes on top of each other to get to this answer. So that's somehow very important. So let me finally discuss this the point I made about sort of trying to guess some kind of Poincaré series. So it turns out that to do that, we don't know this how to do this in general, but we have, in some sense for this case we do. But the starting point really is the local story. So what would you want to do there? So the question once again is replace this dtn of x, which is an integer, by some sort of quantized version. So dtn of x q, which would say be some kind of polynomial with with integer coefficients. And so what would that be? So so dt n of x was some kind of virtual Euler characteristic of this moduli space. And I want to replace that by dt n of x q is some kind of q to the I. And then the dimension of the ith cohomology of this mn of x, perhaps with some coefficients. So which would then specialize back at q equals minus 1, say, to your original computation. And so that can be done, at least in special cases. There are non-trivial coefficient systems, non-trivial topological coefficient systems have to show up here. So you really have to face the fact that this variety is singular. And if you just put rational coefficients here, so your guess might be to put rational complex coefficients there, so that would just be the ordinary singular cohomology of that topological space. And that doesn't seem to lead anywhere. I don't know any result which would compute that and give the sorts of answers we expect. What helps here, and I really only have 2 minutes, so I will finish in 2 minutes. So what helps here are the kinds of ideas that Dave discussed at the end of his lecture. So to the rescue. And I still find this amazing, and I'm not sure it's understood at all why these ideas of supersymmetric gauge theory suddenly crop up here. So the way supersymmetric gauge theory helps here is that we have a quiver description of, well, not all Mn, but certainly we have a quiver description of Mn C3. So that just comes from the fact that to C3 we can associate this quite simple quiver. And in mathematics, I would say, together with a suprapotential, the one that that they wrote down, x, y, z minus x, z, y, and depending on your religion, you might want to add the cyclic terms or not. So that's sort of equivalent data. In mathematics, I would say that the non-commutative algebra associated to this quiver with suprapotential actually turns out to be commutative and actually just gives, in this particular case, just gives the coordinate ring of C3, nothing else. So there's actually no, of course, this is a trivial singularity, if you want. I'm really thinking of near the origin here. That's a trivial singularity. Then corresponding to that, the quiver model gives you actually a commutative algebra, which on the nose is isomorphic. So that in itself is not so surprising. But that helps us to give a sort of ADHM style construction of Mn C3, which is interesting and which does give us a lot of extra information. And in particular, one thing it tells us is what coefficient system to put here. So let me just write down a kind of final result. And stop here. So this is a theorem due to Baron, Brian, and myself. Using the coefficient systems coming from on Mn C3, coming from the quiver description, we can define these quantized dt invariants, which are indeed polynomials with coefficients in Q, and if I look at the generating series dt n C3 of Q, t to the n. So in this case, if I do this for C3, the topological Euler number is 1. So I would just get one copy of the McMahon function. And here I get m of tq. Now let me just say a specific Q deformation of the McMahon function that arose first in Iqbal, Kirschner's and Waffa's paper on the refined topological vertex. So further details on application, let me not write down the formula. The formula is a specific Q deformation of this infinite product. It's still an infinite product. It actually comes with a parameter if you want, and parameter is 3/2. So this was the first indication that these refined or quantized invariants that Iqbal, Kirschner, and Waffa wrote down based on a lot of input from, again, from gauge theory, they have some kind of mathematical meaning. So this was the first time that that was realized. Let me just say very briefly where it comes from. So at some point, Albrecht wrote down this function, which in particular was a function of two variables. And then you got Gromov-Witten theory if you specified epsilon 1 equals minus epsilon 2 equals ig string. And the point is, that's precisely the specialization which we are not taking here. So that was, of course, the motivation of Iqbal, Kirschner, and Waffa to understand this, the full structure of this function from the topological vertex point of view when you don't specialize in this way. And that's exactly the extra variable. If you sort of change variables, then that other variable, which you're setting here to epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2, which you're setting here to 0, that becomes this quantized variable here. So Q equals epsilon 1 plus... No, that doesn't make sense because that's 0. Okay, I mean, you have to reparameterize it suitably. But the extra variable anyway that we are gaining here is the Q is indeed not setting epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2 to 0. So that very much fits into the Nekrasov partition function picture, the Zyberg-Witten picture. And finally, this has an interpretation in DT theory. And I'll stop here. Thank you.